The people that joined me for the cooking event, welcome back. For the people joining us for the first time, welcome. A few rules for me. I ask that everybody take pictures along the way. Send them to your respective chapters, please. We do like to share pictures in between chapters and remember these events. We try to do the best we can with COVID and everything going on. So this is the way that we can all connect together. Two, when it comes to the cooking portion of the night, when it comes to using the stove, I ask that parents, if you're comfortable with your kids using the stove, please, by all means, let them do it, but you must be watching. If you're not comfortable, then parents, you go ahead and take the lead on that. That also goes for the wives in the groups. I know my wife doesn't like me to use a stove sometimes. Just kidding, guys, just kidding. But we're gonna go ahead and get started. Everybody went ahead and prepped their items tonight. Everybody was able to find things. If you're using a different item and have a question, please, by all means, stop me while we move forward. I'm gonna go ahead and flip the camera so you guys can actually see my kitchen counter here. I'll be back at the end here, but let's see. Can everybody see that? See a list of our ingredients, the pans, yes? All right. So the first thing we're gonna go ahead and do is I'm gonna show you a sample plate that I made earlier. I know it's kind of bright, but we're going to try to recreate these. These are my sesame beef tacos that I make here at the house for the kids. I also ask, if you don't eat radishes or you don't eat cucumbers or you don't eat beautiful red cabbage, just give it a shot tonight. Give it a shot. You'll be surprised what you eat. I don't like pickled vegetables, and this calls for pickled vegetables. So getting started, we're actually gonna go ahead and make our creme fraiche or our creme chili. So we're gonna take a half cup of sour cream. We're just gonna go ahead and drop it right in the bowl. And guys, let me know if I'm moving too fast. Let me know if I'm moving too slow. If your house is on fire, that'd be good to let us know so we know which 911 to call. So we're gonna go ahead and drop that sour cream right in the bowl. What we're gonna do to that sour cream is we're gonna go ahead and add 2 teaspoons of chili flakes. Now, the chili flakes itself, what you're going to see towards the end here when we come back to this, is it's actually going to go ahead and turn this sour cream kind of like a brownish color. And that's okay. That's the oils being released from the chili flakes itself. If you don't like spicy foods, I suggest that you hold back on the chili flakes. If you like it spicier, don't add any more. We always have more ingredients to add to the rest of the meal. A little bit of salt and pepper goes into that sour cream as well. One thing you'll learn about me is I salt and pepper everything, with the exception of breakfast cereals. So your sour cream, your chili flakes, salt and pepper, and that's all that's going to go right into that bowl. Just give that a good stir. And if you guys remember infomercials like I do, the set it and forget it guy, who remembers that guy? Just set it and forget it. That's what we're going to do right now. We're just going to set it and forget it. So leave it on the counter behind
Ronco
me.
Ronco Cooko.
What was it?
Ronco Cooker.
Ronco Cooker, right?
Ronco Cooker, that's right. Just set it and forget it. Sorry, it's my dog. He wants to make an appearance. Rex. All right. Sorry, guys. Stop. Go ahead. So the next thing we're going to go ahead and do is pick. Give me 1 second, guys. I apologize. So the next thing we're going to go ahead and do is we're going to go ahead and pickle our vegetables. So did everybody have a chance to go ahead and slice the cucumbers and radishes early before the call? Is that a yes? Anybody not get a chance to do that? No? Okay. So what we're going to go ahead and do for our pickling of vegetables, and guys, I hate pickling. I hate pickles. I think it makes your hair fall out. That's why I tell myself so I don't have to eat them. But what we're gonna go ahead and do is we're gonna go ahead and add 2/3 cup of white vinegar.
Hey, Edgar, we have a question in the chat. What's the longest amount of time something should pickle?
So pickling, if you actually use the proper pickling technique, can last years and years. I know that some of my friends that live up in the mountains, they've had pickled vegetables for like 5 years. Pickling will actually last almost forever, kind of like canned foods. I don't like it to sit in the pickle juice for that long. So My rule of thumb, if I pickle something at home, I try to use it within a year. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, good question. We haven't seen that one before, so that's good. Good question.
So thank you. So to the vinegar, we're going to go ahead and add our sugar, 3 teaspoons of sugar. Now, if you like pickles, I would add 2 teaspoons of sugar. If you don't, or if you don't like pickles, you can add 4 teaspoons of sugar. This is up to taste. I don't like pickles, but with the 3 teaspoons, it seems to be just enough for me. Go ahead and give that a good stir. Sorry, guys, let me move that there. And you're going to feel that sugar start to dissolve. We want that sugar to really dissolve. So just keep stirring it until we get that sugar nice and dissolved. When you start to get it where you don't feel the sugar anymore, what we're going to go ahead and do is your garlic, which you chopped up 3 cloves of garlic earlier. Just take a third of whatever you chopped up and put it in there. This doesn't have to be an exact science. Baking is a science. Cooking is an art. What is that cool? I didn't get that question. Let me see. What was that question that just came in?
What is the containers to your left? That looks like a neat little way to prep everything.
Yeah, so this is actually called a prep deck. It was actually my Christmas present. So it has a whole bunch of little containers, and then you can actually put the smaller ingredients, right? So like for the sriracha later, you can actually go ahead and measure it out. But you can actually find it online. It's called Prep Deck.
Thank you.
Yeah. So after you add your garlic, you want to go ahead and add a couple drops of soy sauce and a couple drops of sesame oil. I say 2 to 4. I really like sesame oil, so I usually add a little bit more. So I add like 5 or 6 drops of sesame oil right into the bowl with the white vinegar and the garlic and the sugar, and just keep stirring it. Then once you got it nice and stirred, a little bit of salt and pepper again. And then what we're gonna go ahead and do is we're gonna go ahead and add our radishes. I'll probably put this right on top here. Our radishes, I actually sliced quite a bit of them, so I'm not gonna add as many, but go ahead and add your radishes and your cucumbers right to it. And what we're actually doing is we're just doing a quick pickling. These radishes and cucumbers will be great tomorrow. So when you have plenty of leftovers, if you have leftovers, you can actually use these same pickles and radishes. And then if you actually eat all the pickles and radishes tonight, just save the pickling juice. You can actually use this pickling juice again tomorrow. So just put it in the fridge. And just like our sour cream, we're gonna set it and forget it. And how's everybody doing? Can I get a couple thumbs up? Are we doing okay? Yes? I don't see anybody waving their hands like the house is on fire. Good, all right. Let's see, smile.amazon. Oh, look at you, Rich. You overachiever, you.
We have another question. Are the radishes required for the pickling?
No, radishes are not required for the pickling, but like I said earlier, just give it a shot. You'll be surprised what you like. Give it a shot. If you don't like it, you can always pick it off the tacos. If you don't have the radishes, then just use the cucumbers. If you don't have the cucumbers, just use the radishes. You guys can actually use different vegetables for this pickling. It doesn't have to be radishes and cucumbers. I just use cucumbers because then I can put them on my eyes when I'm done to get these bags out from under my eyes, but I'm just, you know, I'm showing that I like spa days, right? All right. So now that we have that ready to go, we're gonna go ahead and turn on our stove. If you guys are at that point of the night, go ahead and turn it on. I set mine to about a medium high. If you're using a convection top like I am, I do it at about 355. So while that's warming up, just a little bit, what is that? My friend says different radishes taste sweeter, i.e. golden radishes. Is that true? Yes, so different color radishes actually do have different flavor profiles. The red ones are pretty mild. The golden radishes are a little bit sweeter. But it's just like, you know, red cabbage versus regular cabbage. A red cabbage is a little bit sweeter when you cook it than a white cabbage is. So white cabbage is a little bit milder. I like to use red radishes, not only for the presentation, but I usually generally have a rule of thumb. I try to add as many colors to my plates when it comes to vegetables as possible, because you get a lot of different nutrients from different vegetables, especially like dark greens, reds, you know, different things like that. So you want to try to incorporate as much as you can. Does that answer your question, Brittany? Okay, there we go. Sorry, I got you guys about like this big on different boxes on the screen here. So, all right, so now that we have our pan that's warmed up, go ahead and drizzle in some olive oil. Give it a good amount, don't be scared. Olive oil is actually good for you. I put about 2 tablespoons of olive oil in there. And if you guys can't hear me, please let me know. I know there's a fan on this. If I can figure this out tonight. I know there's a fan on this that makes it loud, so please just let me know if you can't hear me.
We can hear you.
Okay. So what we're gonna go ahead and do is, it's warming up, we're gonna go ahead and take our scallions that we sliced up earlier, or sorry, our green onions, right? So we're gonna go ahead and just drop those in. We wanna do is we wanna make sure that this pan is not too hot. We kinda wanna sweat these green onions out. And the reason we wanna do that is when you sweat green onions, it actually gives it a nice flavor, a nice sweet flavor. So if you think about it, how many of you guys like the blooming onion from like Outback, right? Or like onion petals. So what they're doing is they're actually cooking that so you get the sweet flavor out of the onion. So we're gonna go ahead and add those. After that kind of cooks down for a little bit, we're gonna go ahead and add the rest of our garlic. Make sure to stir it around. You don't want garlic to burn. Burnt garlic is not good. I don't know if you've ever burnt garlic, but it makes whatever you're eating unpleasant. And once that's kind of cooked for about 30 seconds, 20 seconds, we're gonna go ahead and add our cabbage right in. So what you wanna go ahead and do is add all that cabbage that we shredded earlier. It will cook down. I know it looks like a lot, but it will cook down. And what we're doing with the cabbage is, not only are we adding a little bit more filling to the meat, but we're incorporating some vegetables to this, right? So we're incorporating some things that we normally wouldn't eat. Because how many of you guys honestly have ever had tacos with cabbage in it? Pretty sure not a lot of people. And this style of cooking, this Asian style infusion cooking, in the Asian culture, they actually eat a lot of vegetables. They eat more vegetables than average. The reason is, you know, vegetables are usually cheaper than meat, but it also helps with portion control, right? So vegetables will actually, with the fiber and all the good vitamins, will fill you up quicker. I'm adding a little bit of salt and pepper too to this. Once again, I add salt and pepper to everything. We'll let that cook down a little bit. Everybody still doing good? I like to see people running around. That's always a good thing. Rich, are you actually doing the cooking, or are you just standing in front of the camera?
We're doing cooking here. Michael's doing the brunt of the work. I'm
All right, so what we're looking for in this cabbage now, guys, is, remember, when you put the cabbage in, it was real, real firm. And it was almost like a light purple. As you cook it, it's gonna start turning into a darker purple. That's the color we're looking for. I'm actually gonna pull out a few pieces here. I suggest you don't try this at home. I did go to culinary school. I am a chef, so I don't have fingertip feelings. But you're looking for like a really dark purple, if you guys can see that. So that's the color you're looking for. And you're also looking for it to be a little bit pliable, right? So you're looking that you can bend it. Once you get there, you have about another 30 seconds, 45 seconds before your cabbage is done. You don't want to overcook your cabbage, because we're actually going to go ahead and add our ground beef to it. And it's going to continue to cook. So I got a pound of lean ground beef here. I know, you know, it's the new year. Everybody's looking to lose weight or make New Year's resolutions. How many of you guys joined the gym this year already? That's always a good question I like to ask. How many of you guys gone to the gym more than three times though? Yeah. I got a funny story about the gym. So this guy, a really great sales guy, I walked into this gym and he goes, "Hey, Mr. Martinez, we got a really good deal on memberships. You know, are you interested?" And of course, just like everybody else at the start of the year, I want to lose weight too, right? You know, we gain all that weight from the holiday party, all those cookies we made. Somebody had to eat them in my house. And so anyways, I joined the gym and the guy goes, "Hey, Mr. Martinez, we look forward to seeing you." And I said, "Yeah, you too." Guys, it's been 2 years. I haven't seen the guy again. I haven't gone back to the gym, but you know, one of these days I'll get there. So as we add this ground beef, we're gonna go ahead and add a little bit more salt and pepper to it. And what we're looking to do is we're looking to brown the ground beef, okay? This isn't a process that needs to happen really fast. If your pan's too hot, turn it down a little bit. We don't wanna overcook the cabbage. Any questions so far? I go on walks around MA, is that Massachusetts? Brittany? Oh, bless your heart. I feel so bad. I listened to all you guys and your snow stories and how much snow's falling up there. I'll tell you right now, the snow looks great from my laptop from Florida. We don't get snow, but we were under a tornado warning today, so that's always fun. Yeah, there was really these cold fronts. After they drop snow on you guys, they bring tornadoes down south, so. But everybody around here is good. It's still snowing here in Connecticut. Ooh, how many inches of snow have you got, Melissa? About 5, wow. Yeah, I wouldn't go to work with 5 inches of snow. I know that's not, that's nothing for you guys, but for me, I'm not going to work, sorry. I'm calling my boss saying, I don't know how to drive in this. Plus 2 feet from the previous day. So you guys are at 2.5 feet. Are you able to get out of your house? Is there a rule about adding raw meat with veggies? I always cook it separately out of habit. Brittany, okay. So let me answer this question first. So yes, there is a rule. If you are adding raw product to vegetables, you should always add your raw product to the vegetables if you're gonna continue to cook it through. Now, if you are not gonna cook your vegetables through, right? So like, let's say we weren't gonna brown this ground beef, or let's say, you know, whatever the case is, you always wanna make sure you add your meat or your vegetables first and then your meat and cook it all the way through. Very important that you cook it through. We wanna make sure we don't give the family salmonella or any of these bad foodborne illnesses, right? So that's the first thing. Now, your second thing is yes, to you, Brittany, I've also done it separately as well. But when it comes to like tacos like this, when I know that it's gonna cook down and reduce a little bit, when I add the soy sauce and sesame oil in a little bit, I know that it's actually gonna cook everything to temperature, which when we're cooking ground beef, if you're not sure, just take a thermometer if you have one. If you don't have one, please invest in one. And the ground beef should be at 165 degrees. Does that answer it? Sorry, there you go, yeah. All right, how's everybody doing? Thumbs up, yes, good. Mike, you ready to sing?
So those of you in the Northeast, do you guys have snow days like for your kids, like in a non-COVID year? Or do you just, people clear the roads there and you get to school? No one wants to answer.
We can have 2 feet of snow and still have the roads cleared the next day.
Wow.
They do an amazing job here.
It also depends what's interesting, Southern New England versus Northern New England. Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine, and Northern Mass is very different than Connecticut, especially coastal Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Cape Cod. So it really depends. It really depends on where you are.
Well, in St. Louis, we got a half inch and all of St. Louis closed down. So
That's crazy. Wow. Well, can you imagine if even like 1 inch fell in Florida? It wouldn't be good. It wouldn't be good. We already don't know how to drive, so I'd be scared.
So my son, my younger son's high school, the first time we had snow this winter, they just went to virtual school for everybody. And the kids and the teachers protested. So the next time we had snow, they said, they were like, okay, you can have a snow day.
Wow.
Yeah, wow. I think people rely on those breaks, you know?
Well, my wife is a guidance counselor, so I understand, and I couldn't do it. So if we have any educators on the call or spouses of educators, my hat's off to you, because I couldn't be a teacher. My mom's a teacher, or was a teacher for 25 years. My wife is a teacher. She's a guidance counselor now, and I see what they go through, and my hat's off to them. So as we've been talking here, I went ahead and added our 3 tablespoons of sesame oil, our 2 tablespoons of soy sauce, our 1/2 teaspoon of chili flakes, and our 4 tablespoons of sriracha. We're just going to go ahead and mix that up. And what we want to go ahead and do is we want to go ahead and let this reduce a little bit. I know generally most people, what they do is they actually go ahead and let cook the ground beef and then drain it. I don't like to do that. And here's why. When you go to warm it up tomorrow with that little bit of fat that's left in that ground beef and those little bit of juices, you won't have dried out ground beef. I work in a private preschool. They only close the state of emergency. Wow. Is there a substitute for sriracha? I thought I had some, but I don't. Well, Brittany, first of all, thank you for working in a preschool. That's also very hard as well. And then Nancy, yeah. So if you have just hot sauce in the house, you can add some hot sauce to it. Now just be careful, because this is going to be a spicy dish. So if you don't like a lot of heat to your meal, cut back on the sriracha. You don't have to add the chili flakes or the hot sauce. I like my food spicy. So you'll get a good whiff of it. If you want to add some hot sauce, go ahead and add it, but just make sure it reduces a little bit in the pan so it gets right into that ground beef. Everybody doing good? I like this. Everybody's moving around. Ellen? Wow.
Yeah, it was, my relatives live in North Dakota, and even they heard about our 40 inches of snow.
That's crazy. Has this been a higher year? What's the difference between sriracha and hot sauce? That's a good question. So hot sauce is a vinegar base. So sriracha is actually a lot of ground chilies. So that's where the sriracha sauce comes from. They actually ground their chilies a lot more and add water, as where hot sauce is more vinegar based and they don't. So they actually, what they'll do is they'll actually strain out their chilies. So like Louisiana hot sauce, I know that's a famous brand. What they do is they actually grow their chilies and they put them in a pot and they cook them down, but they actually strain the whole chilies out before they put them in the sauce, is where sriracha grounds it up. Does that answer your question, Brittany?
So this was so good last time. I'm making basically a double batch. I should be just taking it through.
That's fine. Take your time.
I was even prepped this time, Edgar, and still I'm somehow behind, you know?
All right, well. All right. How's everybody doing? We doing good? All right. So my ground beef is done. I'm going to go ahead and take it off the stove. I'm going to put it just behind me. I'll take it off my burner, put it on my stove so it cools down a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and clean up a little bit while we're doing that. Does anybody have any questions? Are we doing good? All right. This is a quiet group tonight. You know, this is a quiet group. What is, Brittany, can you take yourself off of mute and explain what Hot Ones is?
You've never seen Hot Ones? It's amazing. It's with Sean Evans, and it's presented by First We Feast, and it's a competition show that celebrities and the host, he asks them trivia questions while they have to eat hot wings from starting with mild to extremely hot.
I think we found our next event. What do you think? Who's down for that, right?
Not me. I have too many acid reflux issues, so mine.
Rich, are you very mild. Had a hot wing challenge.
I'm good. I like it spicy. So the hotter the better, but not like wasabi hot. Like I'm like wild. Sweet baby Ray's buffalo sauce sriracha kind of hot.
Okay.
I'll come up with the questions, and someone else can eat.
Well, the good news is Kristen has volunteered to eat all my hot wings from Missouri. I'll cook the hot wings. Kristen can eat them.
I think that's a bad idea. This is a new thing we're going to add to the adult retreat, Bridget, a wing eating.
There you go.
I'm in.
So how's everybody doing? Is the meat coming along? Is it done? Are we good? My husband put sweet baby Ray's on everything. Oh, well. Sweet baby Ray's is actually a really good sauce. So I would have to agree with your husband on that. I've seen that Gordon Ramsay and Kevin Hart do one. That's hilarious. Well, Melissa and Brittany, I'm going to have to check that out after I get finished up tonight and clean up. Hopefully it's not too funny, because by the time I check it out, the kids will be asleep. So hopefully I'm not laughing too loud. All right. So what we're going to go ahead and do here is we're going to go ahead and start warming up our tortillas. Now, this is an optional step. Tortillas actually, when they come out of the package, are fully cooked. The only reason we warm them up is to make them a little more pliable. So we're just going to go ahead and put it on medium high. I would say about 8 tortillas is what you want to warm up for the family. Depending on how many you got in your pack, you can warm up more, you can warm up less. I'm only going to warm up a few because it's only me tonight. So we're just going to give them a few seconds on each side. While we're doing that, I'm going to go ahead and grab my serving platter that I will show you how I serve these for future reference. Any questions? Let's see. No, we're good. You guys are such a great group. Can we do this again? Because I don't think I've ever like seen people keep up so quickly.
I think it's because we have such a great teacher over here, Mr.
I know. Bridget's so nice, right?
Yeah.
Are you doing anything other than tacos, Edgar?
Right. Yeah, so I do pasta. So tomorrow night I'm actually hosting a pasta event. So like a Valentine's Day pasta event.
That's cool.
You know, the sky's the limit on recipes. Like I said last time, you know, we have, you know, whatever you guys would like to learn to cook. The good thing about going to culinary school is I have a base in almost every cuisine. So no matter what the cuisine is, I know the basics of it. So if there's something that people want to learn how to do or have questions on or want to do as a group, we can do it. You know, I really did like the baking event. It was actually fun. Have a knowledgeable chef. Thank you. Are you calling me chief? Did I graduate to chief now? Yes, I love it.
I spelled it wrong, but I'll take it.
But yeah, so... you know, one of my favorite things to do is Italian food. I love Italian food. Love showing how to make it a little less on the calorie side, right? A little more healthy. Because how many people love Alfredo sauce?
Yes.
Right? Alfredo sauce. How many people know that Alfredo sauce is basically just heavy cream?
Yes.
you know, oh, there you go. Can we do a classic Italian lasagna? Ooh, I like that. That'll be good. What do you guys think? Italian?
Yep, I'm in.
Yeah?
Sounds like the next virtual cooking.
Oh, I like that.
Edgar, have you done the TikTok like craze with the tomatoes and feta, that pasta yet?
I have not. Is it good?
I did it. It was great. Yeah.
Yeah? All right. Well, I'm going to have to look it up.
The cool kids are on TikTok, Edgar. Got to catch up.
All right. I guess I do got to get a TikTok, huh? I don't know if people would watch, though. I like to teach, but I'm not funny like the rest of them. All right. So here's what I did. And I'm showing you guys this because everybody has a misconception that soft tacos can't stand up on their own. just like the song Lean on Me, they can stand up on their own. If you start with the first one and just raise one side, that'll lean up on that side, and then just follow that all the way down. So you don't have to do it this way. You can serve it on platters and have everybody just dig in. I like to do presentations for, like, you know, when I have parties and people over, which hasn't really been a lot because of COVID, but one of these days I hope to start again. So what we're going to go ahead and do is I'm going to show you how I plate these. Now, once again, I've asked everybody to take pictures. This is an important part. So I want to see everybody's plates once they're done. So I'll show you how I do this. Well, what I do is I take about 2 tablespoons of ground beef mixture with cabbage, and I just scoop it in. I like my tacos full. I don't know about you guys, but I kind of get mad when I get a taco that's half full. So I like my tacos like spilling over. It smells so good.
Yeah, whose stomach is growling just looking at all this food in front of us?
Yes.
By a show of hands, how many people?
Like, this was super outside of my norm, like especially with the cabbage and everything, but it smells phenomenal and I'm pretty excited. I don't know if I'm just starving, but it looks really good.
Well, that's great. Well, and that's what I was going to ask. By a show of hands or wave at the camera, how many people are going to eat something tonight that they normally don't eat? Pretty much everybody. All right. I like it. All right. So once we have our ground beef on there, go ahead and take about a teaspoon, 3/4 of a teaspoon of the creme or the sour cream of chili in it. Just go ahead and scoop it on there. Now, if you don't like sour cream, you don't have to add it. If you do like sour cream, you can add more, you can add less. Cooking is, like I said, it's an art. It's not exact science. You know, so add what you would like, take out what you don't want. It's okay. All right, so now that we got our sour cream on there, we're gonna go ahead and take our pickled vegetables. And this is where you kind of can get a little, you know, artsy with it, impress your friends. So what I like to do is it's like Christmas. I take a green one, a green one, and a red one. And then I just put it right on top. You can do 3 instead of 4. You can do 2. You can do none. You can do all red. You can do all green. Then I'll just finish these off here. All right. So then what we want to go ahead and do is we want to go ahead and take that cilantro that we chopped up and haven't used yet. Just want to at a higher angle. I know you guys can't see it. I'm about 6 inches off my plate here. Actually, I'm about 8 inches off the plate and just sprinkle it on top. It's okay if it makes a mess. You're supposed to make a mess when cooking. That's why we have, you know, significant others to clean the kitchens, right? I cook. I don't know about cleaning. Where did you get the organizer? So to be honest with you, my wife got me the organizer for Christmas, but Rich did put a link on Amazon.
And there is other options too that are not as not that price. So I think you just opened the door, Edgar, to many things that we're going to add to our kitchen here.
There we go. And then what I like to do is I kind of like to add a little presentation to this. So I take a little bit of the sriracha. I just drizzle it right over it, right over all of them. A little bit of salt and pepper. I see some people eating already.
Edgar, you love your salt.
I do. And then if you have some, which I actually just found, sesame seeds that I don't even know how old they are, but sesame seeds for sesame beef tacos, just sprinkle over the top. If you don't have any, it's okay. But here are the sesame beef tacos. Yeah? Are they good? I see some people eating. I see thumbs up. Stephanie, I see you chowing down.
Can you say hi? Ellen, can you say hi, everybody?
Hi.
Yeah. Hi. What did we make at our house? What did we make?
Tacos.
Before you eat them, be sure to get a picture with a family. I see the Miller is taking a selfie there. Nice job.
I love it. A lot of activity.
When it's quiet, it means everybody's working hard.
Wow.
Yeah?
If anybody doesn't like their dish, I live in St. Charles, Missouri. Deliver it right over.
This is fire. Wow.
You guys like that?
Uh-huh.
Fire. Loving it.
See, it brings a big, hold on, let me flip this so you guys can see the smile on my face here, because one of my passions in life, not only to share my experiences with hemophilia and, you know, be a patient educator and really reach out to our community members, is my first passion has always been cooking, always. And because of my hemophilia, I had to change career path. If you've worked in a kitchen, you know how much walking is done and standing. And it's not good for the joints. So when I had to change career paths, I was like, you know, my other passion is my hemophilia community because I live with it, but I'm able to combine the two. So like I said, when we started the night, whoever would have thought you'd be eating cabbages, radishes, and cucumbers on tacos? I mean,
Mommy.
this is something that probably when you guys saw the recipe, you're like, this is crazy. This is absolute bananas. I don't know if I want to do this. And I think, Bridget, I'm going to call you out a little bit. Bridget called me and she's like, do I really need to add this? And what did I tell you, Bridget? Just give it a shot. Just give it a shot. Let's see. There was a question. Can you substitute instead of cilantro? Those people who it tastes like soup to. Brittany, you want to explain your question a little bit better there?
Some people, cilantro tastes like Dawn dish soap.
It tastes like soap. Like bad soap. So okay. I can taste it in everything. So I'm always looking for something to do for different on top.
Yeah, so cilantro, you know, it's one of those things that some people, you just hate it or you love it. There's no in between, right? One of the things you can actually substitute it with is actually Italian parsley. So the Italian parsley, you can substitute it. It has a very similar flavor profile, but it doesn't have that chemical kind of like bitter taste afterwards. Another thing you can do to these tacos is you can actually just take a lime and squeeze it right over the top. That will also kill the cilantro flavor. And then also feel free to make this again with chicken, with shrimp, with scallops, with fish, with whatever you decide to do, because the base of this is everything that we did, but you can substitute the protein with anything you want. Also, I did it one day with just vegetables. And I live in a house that eats a lot of meat. Matter of fact, I got two smokers and two grills. So that's how much meat we make in our house, right? But I made it with just vegetables. So I made it with like carrots and onions and green peppers and just all the vegetables I had in the fridge. And my kids absolutely loved it. They absolutely loved it. So that's all I have. Listen, I see everybody eating. See files.
Is that okay to put some cheese on?
You can put some cheese on there. Yeah, definitely. You know, the thing with tacos, that's why I love tacos. Tacos are individual like preference, right? So like the way I like tacos will be completely different than what Kristen likes, than what Nancy likes, and what Brittany likes, and what everybody likes, right? So if you want to add cheese, add cheese. If you know, whatever you got in the fridge, give it a shot. I mean, it's the sky's the limit. I mean, the great news, we can make breakfast tacos, we can make dessert tacos, we can make beef tacos. I love tacos. I'm sorry, especially on Taco Tuesday.
Absolutely. A question also that came in here is, can you explain a little bit more about salt? It was talked about the difference between kosher salt, iodized salt, and why and when you should use one versus the other.
Yeah, so iodized salt and kosher salt. So kosher, right, has to be, for it to be labeled kosher, it has to be watched in the food processing by a rabbi. So that's where the kosher comes in, you know, additives, things like that. And it's a little more coarse. Iodized salt is not as coarse, it's finer. Now, kosher salt, pink salt is yummy too, sorry. I got ADD, I see the chat going all crazy. So when I use kosher salt, I use it more for like, if I were to top off like fish, or I even use it in some, I use it in like some soups because it's a little saltier, right? Iodized salt is kind of like, to me, is table salt. That's the way I look at it. So like even like I'm using this right here. I know you guys can't see it, but this is sea salt. So it's a coarser salt. It just has more flavor to me. Don't be afraid of salt. Also, don't go overboard on salt. But Himalayan pink salt is good too. The different colors of salt have different minerals in it where it's come from. You know, so there's so many different types of salt nowadays that I can't keep up with it. I went to the store just to find some regular salt. And I think there was like 20 different salts here in Florida. So
well, I was going to say there's a couple ways. So I'm doing Weight Watchers right now. Yay. So a couple ways too, to make this a little bit healthier is using, instead of like the street tacos, use the carb friendly tortillas. Instead of using sour cream, use fat free yogurt, and then just add that seasoning to spice it up. So again, you can, light sour cream. Yeah. So there are a couple options too, to make it a little bit, the turkey burger. That's a great idea. I saved my points so I could have real hamburger tonight, not sacrificing everything in this meal. So anyway, so yeah, there's lots of ways to change it up. So you just have to be creative and think outside the box a little bit.
Well, guys, before we end, if anybody wants to, I am on social media. If you want to tag me on Instagram at the Hemo Chef with your pictures of your food, I love to see it. You know, if you want to add it, I'll be more than happy to add it to my page. I love sharing our community members' achievements, especially when it comes to cooking. If you have any questions, please reach out to me. I mean, if it comes to, you know, I have a real soft spot for teenagers, those knuckleheads that don't want to infuse. I'm good at talking to them. I was one of them. So I can share my stories. But anything you guys need, I'm here for you guys. I want to thank Rich and I want to thank Bridget. You guys do an amazing job. You guys are great leaders in our community. And I thank you guys for what you guys do. And that's all I have, so.
Awesome. Well, Edgar, Kristen, thank you on behalf of both chapters, Zach the Farmer, for putting together these innovative and creative interactive programs for community members. If you have photos, please send them to us, as Edgar says. I know both chapters use them in newsletters, on Facebook, on social media. So if you snapped a photo, feel free to send them over and Bridget and I will work together to get something up. So if you have a photo that's handy, we all know if you don't do it now, likely you won't do it because we all forget. But if you have that, just send it over, email it over. But thank you. I know my stomach is growling, you know, hearing this food here. But Bridget, as always, this is a dream to be able to do these events with the Gateway chapter.
It's a dream with us too. So it's so nice. Valentine's Day is right around the corner. So it's nice to have dinner with the people that are important in our lives and all these faces on here. So thank you, Kristen and Edgar and Rich. And Michael, are we closing out by dancing tonight or?
Oh, we are.
All right, let's bring it in. I'm a little teapot. Short suit out.
We'll go from.
Thank you, Edgar. Great meal. Thank you very much.
Thank you for letting me into your home tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Little Whitney Houston to end out your night as you're cooking here.
Awesome. Just awesome. I want to send this to Brad.
dinner, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Please sign up for other events with Gateway and Miha. But we hope you enjoy your dinner tonight. Feel free to dance away. Guys, thank you all. Enjoy your dinner. Have a great night, and we hope to see you at another event soon. Thank you, Edgar. Thank you, Bridget. Thank you, Kristen. Thank you, Dr. Pharma.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.